the great prophecy of the Maasai turned out to be the prophecy for all Africa. When the first white man appears in the land, the nation will die. Chapter 9, Central Africa, Evidence from a Small State. The Kingdom of Cuba. We must not lose sight of what we are doing, the important points of what we have been doing. A partial view of the early history of the blacks, from the loss of their Egyptian homeland to the coming of the Europeans, has been presented through a summary study of a representative number of states. A continent-wide view of what happened to the whole by looking at typical situations. A people forever migrating, forever on the move, forever in flight from threats to survival. A new location found. Sighs of relief and thanksgiving for a new breathing spell, and new efforts at reunification and state building all over again. But every decade of unsettled life, every decade of wandering over deserts, savannas, and through the forests, every such decade was one of retrogression, of disintegration, decades of decline, and no newly established state was able to reach the levels of achievements of the past before it was engulfed either by the Islamic East or the Christian West. This is what we have witnessed, no matter what black state was studied or in what region of Africa it was located. One of these wandering groups, unlike the Congolese and Angolans, began to migrate from the Atlantic seaboard before the whites arrived, was free from contacts with them much longer, and therefore founded a new nation that lasted much longer. The core group was made up of blacks who came to be known as Bushongs. They were moving from place to place toward the interior and finally began the development of the new state during the period when the white storm clouds were slowly rising in all directions. The 200 years between 1475 and 1675, the most critical in the history of the blacks. It was during this period that the great noose of encirclement was completed and fixed, and the blacks of Africa found themselves hemmed in and threatened from all directions, from the north, from the east, from the west, and finally from the south. The white man's march toward world conquest and world domination was in full swing. This most critical period in the history of the race, I say, was such because this closing in on the blacks from all directions was the beginning of the final death blows to what remained of their own civilization. There were dire consequences in terms of their psychological impact on Africans under perpetual danger. A new fatalism emerged that carried the sentence of ultimate doom to the minds of thousands. Some gave up resistance to anything, including a resistance to slavery and resistance to the barbarism that engulfed those who either went backwards or stood still for mental atrophy. Some tried to save themselves by serving the invaders' cause, even if it meant enslaving and killing their own people. Some believed that because the white man came in big ships with big earth-shaking guns, cannons, surely they must be the gods of the world. Others saw no sense in trying to maintain the traditional brotherhood and attempts at unity in the face of such overwhelming odds. Rather, the drive must be to secure these guns and ammunition from the whites, even if it meant ceaseless wars to secure the slaves the whites demanded. Secure them by warring on their own kinsmen in neighboring territories. And still others resolved never to yield, to move and keep on moving rather than submit, to rebuild and keep rebuilding, never giving up, and to fight for unity as the only route to survival. voluntary unity if possible, unity by force if all else failed. These last others were the ones who had the spirit that accounts for the survival of the most bruised and battered of the races of mankind. Such a representative group were the Bushungs. This their record will show. As the Portuguese slave raid spread, the Bushungs moved inland from the Atlantic, enlisting new followers as they moved or temporarily stopped. They were headed toward the Congo region. Fleeing from the whites was not the only problem for them, as it was not the only problem for the millions who had trampled over Africa before them. So when they had settled on the lower Kwango early in the 16th century, their immediate foes were the fierce Yaga warriors, a roaming tribe that seemed to be more interested in raids of destruction than in settling anywhere. They were destroyers, not builders, and they were set on a course to prevent others from settling and building. And while large groups of them did split off from the main body to merge with others and form states, they seemed to be nothing more nor less than bloodthirsty barbarians who engaged in warfare for the sheer thrill of warfare. These eventually opened war against the Bushung state that was forming over a wide area along the Kwango. Under relentless and savage attacks by the Yaga warriors, the Bushungs were forced to retreat along the Kasai and Sanguru rivers, many groups splitting off from the main body and going in different directions. The main body, led by its chief, Woot, entered the plain of Ayul in Kasai and began the formation of a little-known state during the third quarter of the 16th century. It is precisely because it was small and generally unheard of that I selected it for a summary study. There was another reason. It was typical of hundreds of other small black states which, unlike the world-renowned Ghana, Malai, and Songhe, the migrating blacks had built all over Africa, but which seemed to be so insignificant to the conquering Europeans that they were swept away, their people scattered, with no Vincennes to seek out its oral historians to hear how things came to be. What was achieved or failed to be achieved before death came to their society at last. The little kingdom of Cuba, then having its history recaptured, will be telling their story also, telling it substantially as it was in all fundamental particulars. The Bushung, or central organizing group, was allied in a federation of voluntary kindred groups and other tribes, numbering 18 at the outset. The Kwa and the Kete were indigenous. The Kwa, as previously stated, having lived there since the world began. They offered no opposition to the invaders, seemed to welcome them, and became members of the Federal Union under Woot as the elected king. Footnote: there is a record listing Woot in a much earlier period. End of footnote. Many of the splintered off segments from the central groups came in later from different directions to join the federation. Other members were the Mongo, Pende, Igbo, Shuwa, Kel, Kaam, Kayo-Wing, Lalua, Luba, Najinde, Maluk, Payang, Ngumbe, Baying, Kufa, and Mbingi Negongo. From the very beginning, the core group of Bushung set an example for nation building for all Africa, but few African states ever followed it. First of all, The total population at the formation of the Federal Kingdom can be estimated as between 75,000 and 100,000, of which number the Bashuns were 80%. All the other tribes combined, therefore, were only one-fifth of the total population. This means that even under the most liberal democratic system, the Bashuns could have dominated and ruled all the other tribes by the sheer weight and power of overwhelming numbers. They did not choose to do so. Here was what might be considered to be a justifiable occasion to depart from the traditional African constitution with its all-embracing democratic system. Quite to the contrary, they followed it to the letter by simply transforming the village council of elders into a council of state, in which each tribe, now constituting a constituent province, was represented as an equal by its own chief or a representative of its choice. The members of the state council were the electors who chose the king. As it was throughout Africa, the council represented the people, and therefore all powers not delegated rested with the council. The significance of this was that the smallest tribe or province, which might be only 2% of the population, was equal in the council to the Bashun group that was 80% of the population, a situation which head counters might criticize as the very antithesis of democracy. Footnote: the Kayam might be the smallest minority in the Kayam state, but only a Kayam could be the chosen counselor. End the footnote. But the numerically dominant Bashuns seem to have been statesmen with a larger view of what democracy means if it is to operate as a unifying force with divergent and formerly independent groups. What they did, in effect, was to make a frontal attack on tribalism, not by futile denunciations or exhortations, but by actually detribalizing themselves, first of all. They not only treated all of the different language groups as equals, but they promoted a national policy of glorifying those cultural variations in any groups, which were so outstanding that they should be adopted nationally. Hence, every tribe that in isolation had developed something noteworthy but peculiar to itself, no matter how strange or different from all others, could see its unique culture pattern become a national institution and be filled with both pride and gratitude. If the Pende had a different kind of dance and excelled with it, theirs would become the national dance of Kuba. If the Luba excelled in the architectural arts, they would be the leading planners and builders, and so on in all human endeavors. Each group could win national distinction in one way or another for excellence in one or more fields, including agriculture and cattle breeding. The kingdom was south of Zambia in northern Katanga, covering the province of Kasai between the Sankore and Kasai rivers. There were 5 rulers during the short period of 19 years between 1568 and 1587, one being a woman. It is not known whether the council, sitting as an electoral college, set what seems to indicate 4-year terms. After 1587, longer but still fixed terms for kings or queens also seem to be indicated. It appears that these limited terms of office by kings continued during the supremacy of the council. For a long time, 10 years in office seemed to be the limit. This brings us to a third reason for selecting Kuba as both a sample and example state. Cuba shows how the blacks themselves do undermine and destroy some of their own best institutions and replace black democracy with black autocracy without the slightest external influence or aid whatsoever. What is more, and often overlooked, a king may become a despot by the will of the people. This development, incidentally, is a further justification of my rejection of two equally false doctrines. One is the contention of whites that the great institutions in Africa were Caucasian in origin, and the other is the contention of blacks that great African institutions were destroyed by Caucasians and other outsiders and by them alone. What it all means is that the African people act and react just as all other peoples do, with the same motivations, conditions, or similar circumstances, aims, and objectives. The democratic directions of this state was well established in 1587, when Lash Yaeng Mabal assumed the leadership. The economy was still operating along provincial interest lines and apparently without state direction or participation. The market system was the only integrating economic activity along broad national lines. The Bushungs were still the leading boat makers, fishermen, and hunters. Because they were the most numerous, this tended to oversupply Cuba markets with fish and game. On the other hand, farm production was not only far below demand, but it was also too limited in variety. This meant a very limited diet of millet, bananas, peanuts, fish, and fowl. The cloth-making industries expanded as the ironsmith and other crafts developed. The building trades were the busiest in the new nation building. These included architects, carpenters, brickmakers, and masons. The political organization. The political structure actually began with the family council or clan council, which is the basic social unit of kinsmen. During the formative period of the state, each clan had its own village. As new immigrants swelled villages into towns and cities, these became divided into clan sections or wards. Each ward sent its elder as a representative to the village, town, or city council, over which presided the village headman, town subchief, or city chief. These chiefs, in turn, served as representatives of their areas on the provincial council, over which the paramount chief of the whole tribe presided. The paramount chiefs of the central provinces or states, the original 18 founders, represented their provinces in the central state council, over which the elected king of Cuba presided. Conquered states and tribes, which came after the Federal Union was formed, were not eligible for representation on the state council, and their chiefs therefore could not participate in the election of kings. There were other special benefits and privileges enjoyed by the 18 elector chiefs, which other chiefs did not have, or, more pointedly, the newcomers had burdens and responsibilities from which the elector chiefs were free. The heaviest of these were the tributary taxes levied on all chiefs except the original 18. This too was to cause trouble later. The government of Cuba. 1. The Council of State. A. The king presiding. B. The linguist, interpreter, and special aide to king. C. The chief of chiefs, prime minister. The title chief of chiefs actually is that of the king. Here it means to say to all the chiefs of Cuba, when you see and speak to my chief minister, you see and speak to the king. D. The governors of provinces, paramount chiefs. Each paramount chief, or one of his elected generals, was in supreme command of all military forces in his province. The king, who was also a governor of his particular tribal province, had only the soldiers of his province under his command. 2. Administrators, not members of the state council. A. First chief of the treasury. B. Chief of border defenses. C. Supervisor general of tax collection, goods, and services. D. Chief of the king's household and protector of ancestral tombs and regalia. E. Chief of roads and markets. F. Collector general for tributary states. This office was created in the wake of Embung, A. Ling's imperialist expansion in 1650. There were 26 kings during the 342 years of Kuban history, or from about 1568 to 1910. As in the cases of Ethiopia, Egypt, Manchuria, and the other states studied, here also only a few of the outstanding leaders will be mentioned. In thus rigidly limiting the scope, we necessarily passed over many great leaders and important events, just as we shall be doing in the case of Cuba. Here also, we are not as interested in chronological details as we are in such things as the development of national policies to unite diverse tribes in a patriotic devotion to one nation, and other policies that would clearly defeat that objective. The founder or founders of a nation constitute the specially honored group throughout Africa, and it is the source of royalty itself. So Cuba was still following the African constitution when it made the central or nuclear group of 18 founders the permanent ruling council, to the exclusion of strangers. In Africa, all those who came after the community or nation is established. Yet it is equally clear that as newcomers increased the population and as the nation expanded by conquering neighboring societies, the reasons for future conflicts were also being expanded. These reasons, noted here in Cuba, were Africa-wide and account for the internal conflicts in the new African states today, even though all discontent has not come to the surface. And, as in the case of Cuba, the trouble stems from the failure to include every segment of the population in a national program of absolute equality and the opportunity to participate so fully in every phase of the national life that a sense of patriotism and belonging to the nation will gradually outweigh that of belonging to a tribe. In short, what we so depreciatingly call tribalism is in fact the necessary cohesive and social mechanism for survival and defense against threats to survival. The tribe is the unit through which the race itself has survived during all of its migrating and scattered circumstances. The enemies that beset it were black as well as white. This the tribes of today know as well as their black brothers outside of the Circle of 18 knew 400 years ago in Cuba. Tribalism will disappear only when the reasons for its existence in the first place disappear. The most noteworthy thing about Cuba in this connection, however, was that despite the great disorganizing factor just mentioned, its original program of uniting many language groups into one nation was so successful that it has not been equaled by any other nation in modern Africa. For look what actually happened. Many tribes, including the Bushun group, merged so completely that they lost their individual tribal identity and language and became one people, speaking one language derived from all the others. The Baguba, or people of Cuba. This E pluribus unum process that went on continuously all over Africa is what makes the work of ethnologists and linguists so baffling, and their dogmatic conclusions often misleading, imprecise, and sometimes simply false. Splitting off from a major into a dozen smaller groups, each developing a different language or dialect, then the re-merger of any 12 splintered groups into another major group, forming once again one people and one language out of many, and so on until the next segmentation of many and the later reformation of the many into a society and language group again. It is, therefore, unlikely, to put it modestly, that any anthropologist or linguist on Africa could take a group of Bakuba today and determine which had ancestors who were Bushun under Queen Ngogati or Payang when Lashang Mabal was king, or Njinde when Mbush reigned 1680 to 1695, etc. Even members of a group as distinctive as the Pygmies, Kwa, lost their identity through intermarriages with almost all the other groups. Their mingling with other groups was more widespread because, unlike them, they did not occupy a particular province but were scattered in all of them. The descendants of a Kwa Maluk marriage in King Mishe Matun's day, 1620, could not be described as having pygmoid features today, or Maluk either. The reason is simple. There have been too many other crossings and recrossings during the 300 to 400 years that have passed. The religion of Cuba. There was no problem of religious unity in Cuba because there was no problem of religious conflicts in traditional Africa. The blacks, having a common origin and a common center of civilization, had the same fundamental religious beliefs throughout the continent, just as all of their other basic institutions were similar. The inevitable variations were insignificant when compared with the universal similarities. The Cubans believed, as all Africans believed, in one almighty God, the creator of the universe. There were numerous ways of expressing the one God concept. He might be identified with the sun and called the sun god, or, as a variation of this, he might be called the sky god. The numerous other gods, far from being in conflict with the great God, were a necessary part of his divine plan. His own deputies and emissaries, who had direct charge of the various departments of life that concerned human needs, the earth, soil, water, illness, health, fertility, planting, harvest, the forest, war, hunting, fishing, rain, etc. There were lesser gods under these. Their rank or importance was determined by their role and the extent of their role. Different tribes might have different tribal gods, or a group of kindred tribes might have the same sub-gods. Each family or clan might or might not have its own clan god, and each member of the family might or might not have his own personal god. In short, the traditional African religion respecting an almighty God and a hierarchy of lesser deities was later taken over by Christianity in the form of patron saints and higher deities who rank next to God himself. It is said that religion in Cuba did not include ancestor worship. This ancestor worship thing is another one of those overdone myths about Africans. The Bakuba did not worship their ancestors, but neither did other Africans. If Western writers are using the term in the sense that one worships God, and of course they are using worship in this sense, just as they pretend not to understand the role of the numerous African deities, but understand the role of these same deities in Western civilization if we call them patron saints. In the same way as just about every other aspect of African life and history has been misrepresented and distorted. Yet one can understand why a people for whom the idea of immortality is merely a creed would find it hard to understand the all-encompassing religious philosophy of a people who actually believed in life beyond death. From this central belief, numerous other beliefs developed naturally. An important one was that relatives who had passed on maintained a continuing interest in the welfare of those left behind. To justify and preserve this continuing oversight of their ancestors, the living did those things that might merit ancestral approbation. There was ancestor reverence, not ancestor worship. This reverence for elders began in early life with the living and increased with the dead. When food was periodically placed at the graves, nobody expected the ancestral spirits to eat it. Only fools outside of Africa alleged that they did. What they were doing was a demonstration that the communal spirit of sharing was being maintained. Furthermore, if the ancestors approved of their behavior, they were in a position to intercede on their behalf with the deities in times of crisis. The blacks' conception of God was on a scale too grand to be acceptable to Western minds, so they had to reduce it by using a term that is equated with paganism. Primitive, backwardness, and barbarism. The word is animism. But the historian and anthropologist are witnesses against themselves, still proving the very opposite of what they intend. In documenting animism as the chief characteristic of the religion of the blacks from remotest times, they are also documenting the fact that the blacks' belief in the existence as well as the nature of one universal God also goes back to times immemorial. And what is animism? As applied to Africans, it is the belief that the spirit of the Creator or the universal God permeates all of his creations, living and dead. Therefore, any object, animate or inanimate, may be sacred. This concept of God and his creations would be regarded as highly civilized if expressed by a Westerner in some such terms as a reverence for life. Indeed, precisely the same African religious belief becomes the doctrine of immanence in Christian civilization. The Bakuba, people of Cuba, believed that two contending spirits affected man, the spirit of good and the spirit of evil. Evil was thought to be expressed most clearly in witchcraft, which in turn characterized persons engaged in the practice of trying to do harm to others. In Cuba, as throughout Africa, the penalty for witchcraft was either death or banishment. The much misrepresented witch doctor, far from engaging in the practice himself, had the task of combating the practice by trying to help its victims, hence the title witch doctor, which came to be applied to all African doctors indiscriminately because of the widespread belief that almost all human ills resulted from the work of evil spirits through evil operations. Witches. A long chapter could be devoted to the training of the native doctors and their practice of medicine. This is not our purpose at this point, but it should be noted in passing that writers have generally focused their attention on the entirely superficial externals that disguised the African doctor's real practice of the healing arts. They spent years in the forest studying the medicinal properties of various plants and herbs. They went through the same long periods of apprenticeship that the members of all the other skilled crafts had to go through under a master. The people were not fools. The prescribed medicine had to be beneficial. If not, the doctor was held to account far more rigidly than doctors are in our times. The African doctor's entire future in his community depended upon his successful ministrations, and these must overshadow inevitable failures now and then. And while the psychological ritual of hideous mask to frighten off evil spirits, the wild dance and mystical speech were all intended to impress the people with the mysteries of healing, carried over to modern medicine in Latin prescriptions. After all of this, the native physician still had to produce satisfactory results or be disgraced. Religion was involved in the practice of medicine, as religion was involved in every aspect of African life. Disease was believed to be the result of some misdeed on the part of the individual himself or the working of an evil spirit. If widespread, the community as a whole may have sinned, either by commission or omission of something that offended either the deities or the ever-watchful ancestors. Songs, dances, and sacrifices were communal activities designed to re-establish the proper relationship between the people and the unseen powers. History and philosophy. Each Cuban tribe was responsible for its own history, and the state was responsible for the history of the nation. It was oral history. The oral historian, again, as in the case of all other crafts, was a trained historian. His basic training was in a mnemotechnical system. This training in memorization began as an apprentice to a recognized historian other than the principal oral historian. There were special occasions for members of the clan to assemble to listen to the story of the clan, and another occasion for the general community to assemble for the overall history of the nation. The absence of written history made the task of the oral historian very exacting. He was generally held so strictly accountable for any errors made in his account that at times the reaction to mistakes made seems to have been unreasonable. For while he was allowed the widest latitude in commentaries of his own, and even in fantastic embellishments designed to shock his listeners or entertain them, he dared not err in reciting the factual data of history. It seems quite clear that not only the elders, who were also well versed in oral tradition, knew the difference between the mythical and the truly historical account, but the people also understood what was intended as amusement and what was their real story. Aside from tall tales, the historian often used proverbs, reflecting the philosophy of great leaders and that of the race, praise songs of great men and great events, songs which we would call the blues, which told of past failures and heartaches, and dances of victories won and of thanksgiving. But the assembled elders were always keeping a sharp watch out for any serious errors on the part of the oral historian. He might be removed or even banished. In either case, his career would be ended in disgrace, and his disgrace might wreck his life among his people. On the other hand, if successful, the rewards were great, because the oral historian was the community's storehouse of wisdom and one of its most honored personalities. He was the core of the education system. The lineage was the key to the history of the extended family, the tribe, and the nation. Within the lineage were the social, religious, economic, and political ties that held together the family, tribe, and nation. Shyam the Great. Shyam the First was one of the greatest leaders that the black race ever produced, and considering the conditions and circumstances of his time, I think he was the greatest. He became king of Cuba in 1630, and during the relatively short period of 10 years, he set in motion an economic revolution that transformed the nation and gave it a new forward direction. He was not only far ahead of his own time in perceiving that economic development was the only way to restore the ancient greatness of the blacks, but he is still ahead of the whole black world today in the revival of economic activities on all possible fronts. The economy had remained on the subsistence level. It could hardly be otherwise because the nation was still in its formative stage, still very young. The main activities were still in the fields of agriculture, fishing, weaving, mat making, basketry, wood carving, carpentry, furniture making, pottery, iron and coppersmiths, sculpture and painting. There was a remarkable advance in all the arts, especially the pictorial arts, since it was from the latter that the blacks developed their writing system in earlier times and lost it through migrations. One may wonder whether there was any rediscovery and revival of writing in Cuba. Oral history does not tell us, or does it? We do not know. What we do know is that the kind of stable society and institutions were developing in this nation from which writing develops as a compelling and almost indispensable need. Shyam's economic revolution stimulated many facets of the national renaissance about which we know very little. For the revolution of 1630 was a revolution in thinking and a search for new and better ways of doing things. The new king was interested in new styles and a break from the traditional art forms. His drive was for national consolidation and internal development rather than the wars of conquests that so much occupied the time and energies of his predecessors. The slowly developing economy now experienced a sense of urgency and national direction. New crops were introduced. Sorghum, corn, millet, not entirely new in the area, tobacco, yams, and beans. The external influence here was black external influence, and now hardly external to Cuba, because some of the tribes now constituting the nation came from areas where these crops were grown. Would yams and tobacco grow in Cuba? Let's find out. Shyam seemed to have been saying on all fronts, all down the line. The skilled crafts were expanded and methods of production improved and speeded up by new techniques. New weaving and embroidery methods were notable. The break with tradition was most clearly seen in the experiments in new art patterns and new styles in wood carving. All this economic activity meant a marked transition from a subsistence to a surplus economy, and this, of course, led to general prosperity through the expansion of markets and foreign trade. Since Cuba was not within the orbit of the caravan routes of international commerce, her foreign trade was with other African areas. Cuban trade missions were sent near and far to promote trade through the establishment of markets at important trading centers in nearby and distant states. This was the most important aspect of Shyam's economic revolution. In the decline of the civilization of the blacks, as they splintered off and scattered here and there over Africa and over the world, they lost this pioneering spirit of business enterprise. The most urgent need in recapturing their lost status in the modern world of aggressive competition. The traders were also organized into societies. Every occupation except agriculture had its society or guild. Farmers were not so organized because just about everybody was a farmer in addition to his trade. Any townsman who did not have a farm somewhere would have been considered strange. One's trade or profession, then, was seen as possible only because of the basic economy, and for that reason, everyone was responsible for a share in agricultural production. The general prosperity engendered by the economic revolution did not bring general internal peace. The inevitable increase in population was further expanded by the annexation of new territories and the influx of the endless streams of migrating people who were attracted to this new land of opportunity. But they were strangers, and this fact, as noted above, was a cause of general unrest among them, and even greater unrest among the conquered groups. It appears that the national prosperity served to heighten the tensions rather than reduce them. More trouble came from the Bai-Yang elements in the country, members of a major tribe that had challenged the Bushung leadership even before the move from Ayu. Rebellions also broke out just before Shyam assumed the leadership. The Bai-Yang and Kete succeeded in capturing and destroying the capital city, while the unsubdued Bai-Yang continued their attacks from the area still under their control. These internal conflicts were of great historical importance because of the far-reaching consequences. The most important overall outcome was radical changes in the traditional constitution. To begin with, religion was drawn upon as an indirect means of social control by enhancing the divine role of the king. The traditional role of the king as the chief elder and therefore the chief representative of the people before God was very easily changed now to the conception of the king as the lieutenant of God on earth. As God's lieutenant on earth, the king could assume powers not recognized by the Constitution and go unchallenged. But above and beyond this, the internal turmoil was regarded as such a threat to the nation's existence by the loyal chiefs and the people that even more powers than the king had dared to assume were bestowed upon him to enable him to crush rebellions by direct action and restore internal peace. Here then is how a democracy may become an absolute monarchy, not by a coup d'etat, but by the consent of the people themselves. They seem to be thinking only about the others, strangers causing trouble, when they allow the council to give the king the power over life and death, another fatal blow to the African democratic system was allowing the king to raise and maintain his own national army. The national army, as we know, had always been made up of contingents under the supreme command of the council, operating through the respective paramount chiefs and provincial kings. This single change can be said to have completed the triumph of the king of Cuba as an absolute monarch. He had already acquired extraordinary powers, quite naturally, as the kingdom expanded over new territory. New administrative offices had to be made. Some of these were so important that the king encountered no open opposition when he also appointed them as members of the hitherto exclusive state council. This marked the end of the traditional council as it had functioned under the African Constitution. The core council of the 18 elector states was now outnumbered by appointees of the king. It appears that Siam made no display and very little use of his new powers vis-a-vis the elector chiefs. His chief interest continued to be in the field of internal improvement, building a capital city, and upgrading the social amenities that reflect a highly advanced society. These included new forms of court etiquette and procedures, resplendent regalia, etc. One of Siam's stratagems for securing the loyalty and support of important chiefs and other notables was the appointment of their sons to many important posts. This move was significant because it bypassed the nephews in favor of the sons, thus satisfying the natural but never spoken desire of most fathers in a matrilineal society. The King General. Siam left a record of achievements that none of his successors could match. He was a legend even in his own lifetime. The people had never known or heard about such a leader and had never experienced in their own lives the direct benefits of such leadership. It had to be magic, and therefore Siam had been the great magician. Since magic in Africa was simply another religious means of invoking the aid of a deity, to call their chief intercessor with God a magician meant that he was actually securing benefits for the people, and that he was indeed the lieutenant of God on earth. In short, magic was another form of prayer, song, or dance in the appeals to supernatural powers for help. Mbung A Liang, Siam's successor, was not a great magician. He was a warrior king, a great general. He did not have to carry on the economic revolution. It carried on itself from the momentum Siam had given it. Mbung A Liang devoted himself to further wars of conquest and the expansion of the royal power, which these wars made easy. The age-grade military system started by Siam was expanded from a militia to a strong standing army, strong for the period. Prisoners of war, now slaves, formed the king's personal army. they were stationed in separate villages of their own. Now the king was powerful enough to attempt to make the modest changes in the matrilineal system under Siam more thoroughgoing and permanent in the royal family itself. The royal nephews were all placed under permanent house arrest, and sons of the king became heirs to the throne. Meanwhile, they were appointed to important governing posts in different parts of the kingdom, and while it has been suggested that this radical breach of constitutional law was intended to reduce the factional power struggles in the royal family, what it did was to sharpen such struggles along more clearly defined lines. Mbung had divided not only the royal but all the chiefs and people into the defenders of the traditional constitution on the one hand and the progressive reformers on the other. This meant more unrest and more rebellions. The king general dealt with these with an iron hand, was successful, and proceeded with another important assault on the constitution. He outlawed migrations from the country. This had been one of the black man's greatest freedoms, the right of every dissatisfied individual or group to withdraw from the community, migrate elsewhere, and either join some other group or set up a new chiefdom. The universal use of this freedom, let it be remembered at every point, is one of the reasons for so many different little societies and language groups throughout the continent, while at the same time indicating a common origin and background. This relatively small and generally unknown kingdom in the Congo region was a microcosm of black Africa in other respects, and as in other African states, it presents the concrete evidence and specific validation of much of the history of the black people. There was still another development in Cuba that was occurring all over Africa, a development of the highest importance for ethnologists, but one which they generally bypass or treat very lightly. This had to do with still another way new tribes, new chiefdoms, and new language groups were formed, ultimately leaving not a trace of what the respective members of such groups had been in former times. A new tribe and chiefdom of this kind was formed by strays and stragglers, individuals and very small groups that had become detached from their main society during the migrations. Speaking different languages and dialects, they were unaffiliated persons who were lost in the corporate society of Cuba. Even to become second-class citizens as newcomers, strangers had to be members of a single group large enough to have the traditional tribal socio-political structure headed by a chief. Because of these conditions and circumstances, many stray individuals and small groups from different tribes united and began the formation of a new tribe, a new language from the merger of many, and a new tradition or oral history. Here too is how and why oral tradition may become confused and misleading during the first two or three generations. For the first chief and his family, chosen as founders of the new chiefdom, may attempt to overplay their role in the founding and progress of the new society. The central point that is stressed here again, however, is that the historical process in Africa of segmentation, re-emerging, segmentation, and re-emerging ad infinitum defies all attempts by Western anthropologists to divide and classify the race into opposing ethnic societies. It cannot be done either by linguistics or by conclusions arrived at on the basis of widely different physical features and/or characteristics. All these observations can be drawn from the most eventful 50 years in the history of Cuba, 1630 to 1680. Notwithstanding the unprecedented changes in the Constitution, ironically enough, the periods of Cuba's glory and greatest achievements were under the leadership of her three great autocratic kings, Siam the Great, Mbung Liang, and Embo Embush, 1650 to 1680. With the death of Embo Embush, an era of relative peace, stability, and progress came to an end. But that era left us with a perplexing question. Considering the history of the nation before Siam and after Embush, that question is whether democracy actually served the welfare of the people as well as autocracy. It is an awful question, but here is a specific case where the question rises under its own power. In view of the record, no one has to raise it. It therefore has to be faced. It may be that the tradition-bound councils, which we glorify so much because they represented the people and served as a check on chiefs and kings, may also have served to check progress under the leadership of dedicated chiefs and kings of far-seeing vision. This, in turn, introduces the question of the role of leadership in the affairs of men, and particularly in the history of every people that had great leaders who lit the blaze which banished the darkness from their marching paths. Since leadership is indispensable in any group situation, large or small, the ultimate solution in a democracy may be centered around the question not of how much power a leader has, but rather in whose interests and for whose welfare that power is to be used. This presupposes an alert people who know when and where to draw the line between their welfare and the actions of a powerful leader. When Mbung went to the extreme by appointing and deposing chiefs at his pleasure, the people could have checked him. Therefore, the great kings who did so much to build a strong nation also planted the seeds for its destruction from within long before the Europeans completed its destruction from without. From 1680 until the coming of the Europeans in the 1880s, intermittent internal strife darkened the whole period. The struggles centered around the various constitutional violations and changes. These were the main issues, whether the rebellions were led by whole tribes or were civil strife led by royal sons on the one hand and royal nephews on the other. Through it all, however, foreign and domestic trade somehow continued to flourish. In fact, the Cuban markets were so widespread outside of the country that these enterprising blacks attracted the attention of the now world-conquering Europeans. They now had business to explore up and down the Kasai and San Curu rivers, checking on the operations of the Bakuba. Once again, the most crucial points in the history of the blacks were being epitomized by a single small nation. It was to escape the Europeans that centuries before, the people who formed the Cuban state had continued their migrations from the Atlantic seaboard and journeyed far into the interior. They had come on and along the same rivers the advanced scouts of the enemy were now exploring. The blacks, as usual, were too busy fighting among themselves to mark the heralds of their doom or see the significance of their coming. Up to this time, they had been wise enough to adhere to the rule followed by most African states by rigidly barring all non-Africans from crossing their borders. The record of over 4,000 years showed that in each and every case where the rule of exclusion was relaxed and Asians or Europeans were admitted under whatever pretext, the ultimate fate of the blacks was sealed. First, a lone Portuguese came, seeking trade. Who would be silly enough to fear a lone white man? And were not the Cubans, the great traders, always looking for new markets? Nor were the few Germans who came later any occasion for concern other than new opportunities for trade. The exploring expeditions up and down the rivers did not cause alarm. Trading relations with the Europeans were indeed established and were becoming more and more profitable. The Europeans were not yet permitted to settle within the country, but no matter, they were, as we have said, long-range schemers. The pattern of worldwide imperialism had been determined long ago, and the techniques of penetration and dominance were fixed and universally applied. So, instead of invading the country by force, something they were never prepared to do initially anyway, they ringed the country with trading posts along its borders. To these outposts, missionaries assembled to form missions for God and the empire, and were later followed by armed detachments, ostensibly to protect the trading routes and new markets from imaginary raiders. To make matters worse, the European crisis began to develop near the end of the longest and most strife-ridden reign in Cuban history. King Mbunk Ma Mbul was in the fifth decade of his rule, tired and worn out, both by age and endless fighting. Far from seeing the gathering Europeans as a threat, he and his immediate successors seemed to have regarded them as a godsend that would solve two critical problems. The Portuguese offered to buy all of the captured rebels and other troublemakers and the replenishing of a drained treasury by the sale of these war prisoners. The first would tend to end civil strife and restore domestic peace, and the second was a new source of great wealth. To be relieved of the cost and trouble of maintaining prisoner of war camps was still another incentive for selling them. For such reasons, the unforgivable sale of blacks into slavery by blacks began. The fact that African chiefs and kings had a quite different conception of slavery than that of the Caucasians does not excuse them, for in the course of time they had to know that in the West the captured blacks became slaves, in fact, and not, as in Africa, persons who became members of the community, were integrated into families, became members of any of the crafts, had rights to farm land, held offices, and, in fact, had all the rights and privileges enjoyed by their original captives. So, I am saying that while at first the African slave sellers may not have known the fate to which they were consigning their brothers, in time they did learn, and for this reason, these blacks will stand condemned forever before the bar of history. King Ma Mbul, along with the others. The sale of malcontents into slavery did not end the civil strife because, for one thing, all the rebels were neither captured nor defeated. Besides, the permanent center of conflict was in the royal lineage itself. The general upheaval after 1885 the year the European conquest of all Africa began, made it easy for the whites to enter and spread all over the country. The traders and missionaries were the first to take over the country by first allying themselves with opposing chieftains and opposing royal factions, urging on each to keep up the fight against the others. Indeed, the missionaries in Cuba were missionaries of damnation, not salvation. They wore the deceptive garb of religion, but their activities were not only almost wholly political, but were concerned with furthering the disintegration and collapse of this little black nation. They obviously did not come to help, spiritually or otherwise. They came to hinder, at least until the country was completely under white rule. Their next step, therefore, was to actually set up chiefdoms themselves, install puppet chiefs, and rule the country through the chiefdoms over which they and the traders had control. When the 20th century dawned, a dying Cuba was gasping for breath, making its last desperate attempts to free itself from the choking hands it thought had come to bestow Christian blessings. But it was too late. The temporary restoration of the king was too late. The Congo Free State's gesture of assistance was too late. Death arrived according to a schedule, and that was determined by the whites. In 1916, the European-controlled Kat'apé, the last to hold the fictitious title of king to disguise white rule, passed from the scene, and the kingdom of Cuba, having long since died, now had its death certified by the equally small state of Belgium that now ruled a black African region 10 times its size. Cuba was the African experience in so many important respects that it was taken as a case study typical of that experience. We have therefore seen how many of the migrations ended after the people had been uprooted from one place after another. Some to the farthest regions went, found what they believed to be a place of refuge, and began to build again as a separate, isolated society, slowly developing new forms of speech and variations from the original culture. Some found refuge in swamps, caves, and forests, or deserts, where the natural environment alone was an effective barrier to progress and an unspoken command to retrogress to barbarism. Still others, such as the Bushungs, united with other tribes to form a new nation. Out of this new nation, there emerged not only a new people composed of many diverse groups, but also a new language, similarly made up of different languages and dialects. It was also significant that the new state was formed under the guidelines of the traditional African constitution. Kings were to be elected, and the power center was in the Council of State. There appeared to be a studied program of nation building by glorifying the unique cultural offerings of each society and making its contributions a part of the whole nation's heritage. Significant, too, was the fact that religion, like other basic institutions, was essentially the same as it was in the heartland of the race. The sky god was still the sun god, and the sun was simply the obvious way to symbolize the reality of the one god concept, the creator of the universe. The role of the great leaders as benefactors in human affairs was repeated and made clear again in the life and work of Shyam the Great. and in that of at least two of his successors. Siam's economic revolution that promoted remarkable progress and prosperity made his new title of Lieutenant of God on Earth readily acceptable. For were not those leaders who looked after the welfare of the people the instruments of the divine will? As we have seen, a political phenomenon develops from this circumstance in which the people's confidence in the leader is so great that he may be allowed to exercise powers unlimited to further advance the public welfare. It is the genesis of absolutism. Therefore, the study of this state was also a study of how an African democracy evolved into an autocracy without any external influence whatsoever. Cuba revealed something else. We also saw that there was a black imperialism in Africa, all African, and without outside influence. Indeed, we saw the microcosm of all the conquests of blacks by blacks, the oppression and enslavement of blacks by blacks, all of which left us the heritage of suspicion, distrust, and hatred that accounts for tribalism, disunity, fear, and unrest today. In spite of it all, the Cuban state was relatively secure as a black power entity until they allowed the whites to come in. At that point, the history of the blacks in Egypt and everywhere else was being repeated, and in exactly the same way. The blacks had learned nothing from their previous experiences with whites. The blacks were therefore doomed to repeat the same big mistakes over and over, meanwhile losing both their civilization and their freedom. As the last days of the kingdom show, the separatist chiefdoms struggling for power actually sought alliances with the whites to overcome this or that black faction. They did this in Egypt and lost. There they continued to form alliances with whites against blacks, even after black rule had been pushed southward below the first cataract. The whites were only too anxious to oblige in thus helping the blacks to speed up the work in which they were so busily engaged. Social disorganization and the internecine strife that led to white control of their lives. One may wonder if Kat'ape, the last of the figurehead kings under Belgian rule, ever reflected on how and why the blacks so often sealed their own doom. Chapter 10, White Devils from the West. Before the 16th century, most Africans on the continent had never seen a real white face. Since in many societies all devils and other evil spirits were white, the ritual to ward these off was always led by chanting dancers whose faces and bodies were hideously painted with white chalk. That there were in fact white humans living, white devils, was unbelievable. Probably few reports are better known than those of first contacts, where the boldest of the unbelievers would venture to rub the skin of whites to see if the paint would come off. Over 1,000 years had passed since Assyrians, Persians, Greeks, Romans, Arabs, and Turks had taken over Egypt, and Arabs now also ruled the eastern Sudan. Arab Hebrew rule was steadfast in isolated Abyssinia, while the Arabs along the east coast, operating from their Zanzibar stronghold, had not themselves ventured far into the interior. Their Afro-Arab agents generally spearheaded slave-hunting operations. Ghana and Mali had disappeared, and now Songhai was making its last stand against Arab, colored, and Berber armies from across the desert. Even there, Where black armies clashed with invading white armies, the masses never saw white people. This refers not only to the countless thousands who fled upon the approach of enemy troops, but also to those who remained scattered over the country in their villages. Now things were changing rapidly, and the people were becoming sharply aware that they were being hemmed in from all directions. To begin with, the Arabs were spreading out and penetrating formerly forbidden borders of black states. Being the longest of the whites in Africa and the freest in amalgamation, because of this, there were millions of brown Arabs, dark-skinned Arabs, and near-white Arabs. They could therefore enter black territory from which whites were barred. These black Arabs, many were unmixed, confused African leaders everywhere, increased the tensions and tribal wars among them, and helped mightily in destroying the independence of African states. Having discussed this in connection with the fall of the Maasai states and elsewhere, my return to the same subject again is to keep a focus on the racist self-imposed chains as well as on those imposed by the whites. A further reason is that blacks themselves do not like to discuss these internal handicaps at all, not even among themselves. We prefer to pretend that certain things do not exist. This fact in itself is a weakness that strengthens the white power position over the blacks. The Portuguese were the first white European people to arrive in West and Central Africa. They were not long in adopting the Arab strategy in dividing the blacks against themselves, a strategy since adopted by all white people. The Congo-Angola story. The Portuguese arrived at the mouth of the Great Congo River in West Africa in 1488. Their aim was to make their tiny European state into a vast African Indian empire. They had two men of vision to inspire the all-out efforts to realize the dream: João I and his son Henry. Africa had been secure from invasion from this quarter during all the centuries the Western world believed that the earth was flat. Now the myth had been exploded when in 1434 Gil Yanes dared to sail beyond the area where the Atlantic Ocean was supposed to end and ships plunged into the void. He sailed around Cape Boador. Thenceforth, the blacks of West Africa had to confront the white devils from Europe and the Americas. The Portuguese, as ignorant of the African people as they had been about the shape of the earth, were not prepared to find highly advanced states there. The Kingdom of the Congo was their first great surprise, because its political structure and expertly organized administrative machinery equaled that of Portugal or any other European state known to them. That system requires no discussion here, because it followed the same constitutional pattern as that of the other African states already described. The Congo's economic system of agriculture and handicraft industries, organized into guilds, was the same. Apprenticeship training for all skilled occupations was the same. And the general pattern of social organization was also the same as other African societies. The Congo Kingdom was prosperous, carrying on external trade by both land and rivers with states farther north, east, and west. The states to the south, later to become Angola, were in an uneasy commotion due to the increasing presence of foreigners on the coast, on nearby islands, and now sailing up the rivers toward the interior. Migrations from the Angola states increased, even though the Portuguese were then bypassing the region in favor of the more highly advanced Kingdom of Congo. Or was it the flight of so many potential slaves from the coastal areas that caused the Portuguese to move up the river closer to the population centers? It was more likely a strategic move. By establishing a stronghold in the Congo Kingdom, the Angola region would be caught between Portuguese armed forces on the Angolan northern border and those on the seacoast and offshore islands. In short, Portugal was getting in a position to take over this whole region of black states. Many historians and apologists for Portuguese imperialism in Africa use the Congo Kingdom as the classic example of the Portuguese policy of racial equality. For did they not themselves declare this to be their policy? And did not the King of Portugal himself address the King of Congo as brother? What happened was that the Portuguese captains had met Congo leaders, not just the king, who were in fact not only their equal, but men so anxious to advance their nation further that they were willing and anxious for anything new and better that the white world had to offer. They took the Westerners at their word. They had painted their monarch as the greatest king in the world that had advanced to a pinnacle of civilization under the guidance of a universal religion that was headed by a supreme pontiff who was appointed by the Son of God himself. Moreover, this same successor to the first head of the church, the Apostle Peter, would not only welcome the King of Congo and his people into the great Christian fold, but would send missionaries and teachers to help make his kingdom the greatest in Africa. Portuguese records indicate that far more than religion and Western education was offered. Material benefits, such as great wealth from trade, were persuasive. The Kingdom of Congo, therefore, is a case study of the processes of westernizing the very first group of blacks on the African continent. Footnote: the ancient Ethiopian church in Makoria and Alwa had no conscious westernization program beyond the changes in names, and these, like those of Jews, were Bible names. End a footnote. This, however, was only one of the means to a much greater end. Nothing could have been farther from Portugal's real objective than bringing Christianity and a higher civilization to Africa. Christian civilization served as the charm words in the white man's magic, with the incantations which hypnotized both his victims and himself. They believed they were being introduced to a better life, while the latter convinced himself that even the enslaved people were better off under the white standard for civilization, beside which there was no other. He was, therefore, serving God himself in Africa. For did not the churches throughout the Western world so proclaim? And were not the Christian missionaries the most effective servants of empire? The court at Lisbon had planned well. For such a mini-state as Portugal, an ambition for an empire bigger than the continent of Europe, and then daring enough to operate the plan, this must compel a degree of admiration for the kind of Caucasian genius and uninhibited aggressiveness that enabled very small groups of men to go forth to conquer and dominate almost all the peoples on this planet. Portugal's presence in West and Central Africa aimed at nothing less than building an empire across Africa from west to east, from Atlantic Ocean to the Indian Ocean, a vast swath across the continent that would also serve directly as the imperial highway connection with the projected Indian Empire. The African Indian Empire was Portugal's grand design. The Congo interlude was merely a needed stepping stone and base of operations. But they were smart enough to realize that the foundation for a permanent empire in the land of another people and built with their own sweat and blood would be more successful if the minds of the people could be captured first. One did not go in with guns blazing. Only fools did this, except in cases where the natives were too damn smart and saw through every scheme. no matter how shining the cross or how white the extended hand. In such cases, it was their own fault, yet for their own salvation, that Christian canons had to blast away. First of all, however, the really big thing was to change the blacks into Christians, which changed them into Westerners, which was to change them into the white man's image. The previously mentioned process, the outcome of which caused blacks to reject and become ashamed of both their culture and themselves, the only people on earth to do so. And this is why it is important to have a close-up look at the process of westernization in the Kingdom of Congo, where it began. The missionaries began their work on kings and notables. There was nothing new in this approach. Indeed, the Congolese were so anxious for the new education and its vehicle, Christianity, that the priest found their task easy. First of all, to become a Christian, one had to be baptized and given a Christian name. Christian names were Western names, and they all took the form used in the conquering country. The first Congolese king to become a Christian was Nzinga Kuwu in 1492, taking the Portuguese name of João I. Hundreds of other blacks immediately followed his example. Princes, chiefs, ministers, and some of the masses. The most notable Congolese kings who became black Portuguese were Afonsos, Alvarez, Dom Pedros, Diogos, etc. Overbearing Jesuit fathers were installed as counselors to the king, one functioning as a prime minister. This move at once destroyed the troublesome traditional council that controlled chiefs and kings, and with such councils, no European power could operate. The age of absolutism, with the rise of the nation-state in Europe, was directly reflected in the Congo Kingdom. With this Portuguese wedge between the king and the people, the Congo rulers now found themselves free to make important decisions without reference to black counselors. Footnote. Since the Congolese rulers were migrants into the territory and extended their kingdom over indigenous people, the king's appointment of key officials was one of the same routes to autocracy I have discussed in connection with the rise of new African states following migrations. End of footnote. They therefore tended to become absolute monarchs, insofar as their own people were concerned, but generally puppets in the hands of Europeans. The exceptions were Afonso I and Diogo I. The idea of divine kingship was promoted through the anointment and crowning of kings by Portuguese bishops. Kings now ruled as sons of the church, chosen by divine decree to serve it. This means serving the Portuguese by meeting their demands, always made as friendly suggestions from brothers who were equal in Christ. Even the traditional political system was made to appear as a Portuguese creation. It was already highly and efficiently organized before any Europeans came, organized with each village and town under a chief called Manai, each district under a Manai, and each of the six major provinces that made up the kingdom was under the administration of a governor, also bearing the title of Manai. Now, in addition to the widespread use of Portuguese names, important Portuguese titles appeared, such as dukes and infantes. A new class of princes, hitherto never used in Africa because the Western conception of royalty was absent. Here, then, is another case where the external influence school can have a field day. Since nothing is better known and nowhere denied than the fact that the Africans who adopted European or Asian institutions, such as Islam and Christianity, for example, were not only influenced by them, but often transformed into black Arabs, black Portuguese, black Frenchmen, black Englishmen, and so on. In fact, it was this very transforming external influence that played a decisive role in first destroying the best in African civilization, while at the same time giving worldwide publicity to all remaining elements of barbarism that could be found. The new masters of the continent were in the position of all power and could therefore make their viewpoints the viewpoints of the world. The system of reducing blacks to non-persons was so thoroughgoing that not only did the various people of the world regard them as such, but tragedy of tragedies, the blacks themselves came to feel inferior and to hate themselves and all of their kind. Magic? Here now indeed a magical thing had happened, since these whites, who called themselves Portuguese, had arrived. As the 15th century moved on toward the 19th, the Europeans became less and less white devils and more white masters, backed up by awesome firepower. White was no longer the face of evil in the black world. It had changed places with black. Now black was the badge of evil, all that was bad, even bad luck. To make a white man look evil, you had to dress him in black. Life's final tragedy, death, called for mourning in black. Happy events, such as baptisms and weddings, required the wearing of white. God himself, being white, had cursed the blacks and made them the servants of man. Man being white man. For was not he made in the image of God? To worship God, in effect, was to worship the white man. A volume could be written on the scores of these little psychological gimmicks that are now so deeply embedded in cultural thought that they are taken as a simple matter of course and require no comment. Yet they are the subtle weapons which have been more devastating in conquering the blacks and reducing them to an inferior status than armed might. Caucasian victory was complete and seemingly permanent when the blacks throughout the world joined the whites in glorifying all things white and condemning all things black or even tinged with black, including themselves. Here we are at the very heart of the race problem. This self-abnegation, self-effacement, the loss of self-identity by cutting their roots with the past and thereby losing the very links with their history from which a people draws strength, inspiration to move forward to even higher ground, and in fact, the reason for being. In short, in the incongruous attempts to replace his own values with those of the white man, the black man lost his own personality and therefore his manhood almost absolutely. Nearly 500 years have passed since the first Europeans landed on the coast of West Africa, and their phase of transforming blacks from men to half-men began. Yet, even with this long background, there are countless millions of frustrated blacks, frustrated by the perpetual annoyance of the blurred vision and the blank wall as they struggle to see life through the blue eyes of Caucasians. The status of African people throughout the world remains too precarious to deal with their history by merely chronicling important events. The situation demands that greater efforts be made to determine the meaning of those events, their effect on the people, the overall change in the direction of history, and what new direction the race must take. The major and immediate Portuguese aim in Africa was not the conquest of blacks. Rather, their first aim was to destroy Arab power in Africa and the Islamic control of just about all of the overland trade routes to the east. For this cause, Columbus had sailed, and other European nations took to the high seas. The Portuguese sought to use religion as the usual spearhead. That Christian states were in Africa from the earliest times had not been completely forgotten. Footnote: there was no reason why the ancient African church should have been forgotten at all. The Vatican records and those at Constantinople were available. End of footnote. One that had escaped Muslim destruction was located in what had been a southeastern border state of the ancient Ethiopian Empire, identified by the Portuguese as a kingdom ruled by a King Prester John. The idea was to unite the Christian forces of Europe with those of Africa in an all-out war against the Arabs. But what was not generally known was that the kingdom of Aksum, expanding to become the Empire of Abyssinia, was ruled alternatively by Christian Arabs and colored Christian Hebrews. All Arabs were not Muslims. All Hebrews were not Jews in religion. It appears that African Hebrew and Christian Arab communities were in southern Arabia and Yemen, just across from the East African country they later conquered. The Portuguese, however, did not reach the African Christian kingdom at the time they sought it for the promotion of their campaign against Islam. They had therefore begun the work of creating a black Christian kingdom in their own image. This was Congo. By 1512, no one needed to guess or speculate about the Portuguese plans. Their king, Manuel, made them clear in documentary form. The Regimento. This is one of the interesting and significant documents in the history of black people because it was the first detailed blueprint for the conquest of the black man's mind. Acculturation via Christianity, his body, slavery, and his country. This historic document, however, was couched in all the endearing words and phraseology of equality and brotherly love, from which fact historians have declared the Portuguese African policy to be one of equality, replete with humanitarianism. But the Congolese king, Afonso, his Portuguese name notwithstanding, saw through the elaborate plan to reorganize his country and began to throw up roadblocks, albeit too late. Manuel levied on the king a heavy tribute in slaves, ivory, and copper to pay the cost of his Christian civilization program in the country, his various expeditions there, and for the, quote, huge expenses in connection with the education of a few Congolese children in Portugal, including the king's son. Manuel's next most important move was to make certain that his Code de Congo was carried out. He therefore sent Simão da Silva, both as his ambassador and, in effect, Governor General or Viceroy of Congo. While Simão da Silva's real functions were clearly outlined, these were covered over by the usual title of courtesy, advisor to the king or the king's counselor. In this capacity, he was the co-administrator of the nation, a supreme judge, and had control over army and finance. He was to have a comprehensive geographical survey of the country to determine the extent of its natural wealth for direct exploitation. Things quickly got out of hand. The Portuguese settler population, based mainly on the coast and offshore islands desired the quicker riches that would flow from the increasing demand for black slaves. The settlers therefore pursued a more aggressive course of action, ignoring the Lisbon court's attempt to cover the real operations with the friendly language of diplomacy. Up to the 16th century, the people we are calling slaves were not slaves in the modern sense, but laborers either captured as prisoners of war or persons imprisoned for various offenses. So during the first stages of the slave trade, many African chiefs and kings actually thought they were supplying workers needed abroad and at a great profit to themselves. They had had no experience with the white man's slave system or its equation with race. Not at first, we have said, but as the decades passed, and the Congo state is a good example, many Africans became enmeshed in the horrors of the trade, knew what they were doing, and in the pursuit of guns and riches, became as brutal as the whites in dealing with their own kind. Guns. Black leaders saw these new weapons of death as the real source of the white man's power and the immediate threat to their own existence. The earth-shaking cannons that were being brought into Africa seemed to herald the death of a whole race or its total enslavement. The Africans became insistent in their demand for guns as articles of trade. There was then, as now, a silent embargo on arms to black Africa, a sort of white gentleman's agreement. The demand for guns by the chief was pitted against the demand for slaves by the Europeans and Arabs. The Arab slavers had no trouble securing firearms. The chiefs could seriously hamper the trade if their demands for guns were not met. Besides, many slave traders were quick to see that the supply of slaves would double and triple if firearms were given to certain strategically located kingdoms and chiefdoms, for these would then seek to become big wealthy powers, expanding their territories over weaker black states and capturing millions of prisoners to be enslaved in the process. The more aggressive traders were willing to arm such African states as one of the risks capitalists must take in the pursuit of wealth. The more imperialist-minded saw an outcome even more important, that this would be a built-in motivation for perpetual warfare among the blacks themselves, creating an everlasting hatred between groups, destroying every basis for unity, and above all, keep them so busily hating and fighting each other that they would forget their real enemies, the white devils from the sea. The Portuguese Christianization of the Congo created something more than chaos. It was a revolting mess, no matter from what angle it is viewed. To begin with, priests were not only among the leading slave traders, but they also owned slave ships to carry the, quote, black cargoes to distant lands. Priests also had their harems of black slave girls, some having as many as 20 each. They were called, quote, house servants by these holy fathers. The great majority of the whites were the scum of the land from which they came. Even the half-educated priests were generally of the very lowest character, morally and otherwise. The slave situation became more and more desperate and out of hand as every white man, down to the lowly worker, became a traitor. The builders sent over to erect fortifications and other permanent installations for the Portuguese stone and brick masons, carpenters, engineers, painters, metal and other craftsmen were all slave traders. Sailors and unskilled Portuguese laborers had their own quotas of slaves, especially slave girls. For let this truth emerge from the many facts which are buried, and let it stand out clearly. One of the main attractions of slavery, and the magnet that drew thousands of white men on, was their sexual freedom unlimited with all the black girls and women who were enslaved and helpless in the power of their masters. These wholesale raids on black womanhood continued to swell the mulatto population, the majority of which, again, as in the case of Egypt and the Sudan, became the faithful servants and loyal representatives of the conquering races to which their fathers belonged. The Congolese king, Afonso, found himself in the middle of fires from several directions, and hamstrung by the Portuguese advisor who had acquired veto power even over the king's actions. And Afonso was far from being a weakling. He tried, too late, to gain control of the slave trade, which control now became most urgent as every black that competing raiders could get their hands on was enslaved, including some members of the royal household and numerous title holders throughout the country. On the other hand, the King of Portugal declared a royal monopoly over the trade, and this not only frustrated Afonso's efforts, but clashed head-on with the interests of the powerful and independent slave merchants, the real controlling settlers on the seacoast and inlands. These were representatives of the great chartered companies that controlled the commerce of the world, since they operated under royal charters and the court was a principal shareholder in all such enterprises. They could not openly defy the king, but the distance from Lisbon enabled them to bypass Da Silva and any other representative of the king and carry on as they wished. The mission fathers, the, quote, war dogs of the Lord, Jesuits, were most helpful as spearheads into the interior chiefdoms to form slave-hunting alliances in exchange for discarded guns. For those who require the specific details and examples of just how advancing black states were destroyed throughout the African continent, and once the facts repeated over and over again, here then is still another example in both Angola and the Kingdom of Congo. The strategy for destruction seldom varied, and so giving added weight to my concept of a grand Caucasian consensus on matters concerning non-white peoples. The aspect now under discussion was the practice of having white groups spread out over the country into the various provinces, heavily laden with gifts of goodwill, and getting themselves attached to the courts of local chiefs as friendly advisors who were going to guarantee the security of the chiefs and their people, and even extend their power over other peoples, all of which would mean great riches for the chiefs. A few old guns replacing spears seemed to be sufficient evidence that these whites were indeed saviors as well as friends. The French name for them was Agents Provocateurs. The American name would have been CIA or AID. No matter how strong and effective the administrative machinery of the central government at San Salvador had been, it was being undermined and destroyed by the well-planned European activities in the provinces, the identical activities that had been carried on in the Egyptian provinces 3,000 years before in Cuba and would be repeated all over Africa. The aim was to provoke war between the blacks, pitting the gun-armed groups against those who only had shields and spears, and thus skyrocketing the number of captives for slavery from a few thousands into millions. Not only were whole villages destroyed, but entire provinces were depopulated, and their formerly proud and free citizens marched off in chains, collared and joined together with heavy poles, just as though the chains that bruised and bound hands and ankles were not enough. Many royal lineages were among the captives, including chiefs, which is exactly how it should have been if any of the people were to be enslaved. According to African tradition, leader and people were one and the same, sharing a common lot. This sense of oneness, however, applied only to the members of one's tribe and not to Africans outside of it. Another tragic fact of black history. This is why the chiefs and kings would secure prisoners of war by attacking other states. Only a savage chieftain would sell his own people into slavery. The Europeans learned this very quickly and found that it fitted in well with the general plan to keep the blacks divided, forever suspicious of each other, and to have these mutual hatreds and suspicions historically derived not from anything the Europeans had done, but from the blacks' own record of tribal warfare. As the slave raid spread throughout Angola and Congo, the blacks continued to flee again overland and up the rivers toward the central and southern areas, toward the great savanna regions and the lakes. Some, as we have seen in the case of Cuba, found security long enough to rebuild remarkable states again. Others found security only in the hidden recess of decay and decline. Meanwhile, the fierce Yaga warriors were still on a rampage, fighting with or against any group, including the white slave traders. But since the Yaga generally waged war only against their own kind, Africans, the Portuguese were less hesitant in supplying them with guns. The wars to capture slaves had become so widespread among and within the various states, and the slave trails to the coast were so heavy with barefooted traffic that it is difficult to see why any alliances with the Yaga were needed unless it was thought to be necessary to make up for the unbelievable death toll among the captives. For every 2 million blacks enslaved, over 1 million died. The record indicates rather clearly that many millions preferred death to slavery. I just said the record indicates, but you will never find a single Portuguese, Dutch, Spanish, English, or American document that explicitly says any such thing. The archives in Lisbon are rich to overflowing with African documents going back 500 years. By wading through a great mass of such written records, the historian often gets a picture that was not intended for painting, and messages from the same documents which were not sent, which is merely another way of saying again that written documents often reveal far more than their authors intended. You will therefore search in vain for an account written as the following. It is not true that all women and even children were likewise marched in chains. This would have been unnecessary anyway, because we had learned that these black women are so loyal to their men that they would follow them even into hell. Capture their men, and you did not have to capture them. Yet many of these same women would seek death directly by attacking us and our armed guards. These, of course, were beaten and chained the same as the male slaves. Another problem was the large number of suicides during the 200-mile trek to the slave pens on the coast. The greatest number died from poison, which hundreds of women would conceal on their bodies for the purpose, passing it to friends and kinsmen in the darkness of night before giving it to their children and finally taking it themselves. All this slowed us down during the night when we should have moved faster because it was cooler. Yet, the dead and the dying had to have their chains chopped off from the living. Many babies were deliberately smothered to death by their dying mothers. We do not believe that the other deaths were caused by the long march, as some allege. For while it is true that we ourselves are carried in hammocks, the bearers are changed every 10 or 15 miles. The biggest and strongest boys are selected to carry us. They are usually between 10 and 30 years old. They also collapse sometimes, but only 5 have died during this year. It must be remembered that these blacks are quite used to walking very long distances with heavy burdens. There are many problems in this business. The captains, taking it easy on the coast, are always complaining about our slow movement and the many weeks it takes on the march. They never take into account how much we are slowed down by tramping and stumbling over the skeletons and rottening dead bodies of slaves that went along these trails before us, sometimes years before us. The stench of those who died recently is unbearable, yet we bear it. We also lose much time trying to find routes down which are free of the dead and dying. Then there are scores and scores of perfectly healthy blacks who drop dead without any apparent cause. Some say they die out of sheer spite, another way of defeating us. We work in fear, for our guns are often useless in the increasing number of ambush attacks along these death-ridden trails, and while the Congolese kings now harass us in their attempts to check the spread of the trade, the real danger is in the Angola region, the region of the Black Terror, in the form of a death-defying black queen, and Nzinga. Who ever heard of a woman general leading her armies in person? The truth is that she is the greatest military strategist that ever confronted the armed forces of Portugal. Her tactics keep our commanders sweating in confusion and dismay. Her aim is nothing less than the total destruction of the slave trade. To this end, and what alarms us most, she has developed a system of infiltrating our black troops with her own men, causing whole companies to rebel, desert, and join her armies in what she calls a war of liberation. Portuguese casualties are always heavier than reported, for she stages surprise attacks with lightning speed, always aiming first to capture guns and cannons. And while we now surround ourselves with armed guards on these long marches, we never know how many of our black soldiers are the Queen's own men. This would have been a true account up to 1663, when the 40 years of unremitting warfare that Queen Nzinga waged against the Portuguese to free Angola ended with her passing. Africa had lost her greatest daughter, the slaves their greatest emancipator. Where is this explicitly written? Nowhere. It has been pointed out that Afonso was himself a statesman, and far from being a mere puppet in the hands of the Portuguese. Even though the process got underway with his conversion to Christianity and the replacement of his own African name with a Portuguese one, he was awakened by the cold and began to resist and reject those provisions which were designed to make Africans black Portuguese in the name of Christ, while destroying their sovereignty at the same time. The fact that the enemy prevailed in the end does not detract from his stature as a great African. The pressures had increased as Portuguese riches from the slave trade, far from satisfying their greed, led them in excited searches for gold, silver, copper, and lead they believed to be in abundance in the region but concealed by the blacks. Pressures from the African population increased with the widespread slave hunts and raids. Historians have highlighted the role of African chiefs and kings in the slave trade. Little is said about the general African opposition to the trade or about the kings and chiefs who led the fight against it. Yet, by the very nature of the situation, these had to be as well known as the blacks who enriched themselves from the traffic. Queen Nzinga was not the only African abolitionist. It just happened that in her case, she was not only involved in treaty negotiations of record, but operated over so many Angolan areas that she could not be easily excluded from history. The Congolese, opposing their kings, were fighting both slavery and the Christian church that promoted it. Even the broader education they all so passionately desired turned out to be a farce, another Western bait. The quote-unquote schools, rigidly restricted in number and attendance, were little more than Catholic catechistical classes under semi-literate priests who were themselves not only slave dealers, but the personification of all that is meant by corruption and immorality. All of Afonso's efforts to get at least one good school established in Congo were blocked. For one thing, no real widespread education of the blacks was intended. That would have meant sending over well-trained teachers instead of the unwanted dregs of Portuguese society. But even if Portugal had had the best intentions, she herself did not have many educated men in the 16th century, and her own illiterate masses were just as ignorant as those in the rest of Europe. The situation had become worse on all fronts when Diogo became king of Congo in 1545. Supported by the Lisbon court, factions that could still make or break kings and influence their policies. On the other hand, the powerful trader population had their principal strongholds at strategic Luanda and Seau, Tome, from which points they continued to expand slave operations in, below, around, and beyond Congo, all in defiance of Congolese kings and the King of Portugal himself. They were greatly aided by the King, Angola, of Ndongo, the strongest state in the Angola region. Footnote: the name Angola, later taken from the title for the king, was not yet applied to the region that is now the Portuguese colony of Angola. End of footnote. But Ndongo was nominally under the Congo as a tributary state. In 1556, war between the major conflicting groups hitherto undercover broke out, open and full scale. Royal Portuguese forces allied with those of Congo against Portuguese trader forces allied with Ndongo. Portuguese against Portuguese and Africans against Africans. So it appears on paper in the records. The simple truth is that it was a war of Africans against Africans, with the Portuguese forces safely in the rear. The black troops were to be used in all dangerous situations and white lives safeguarded whenever possible. This was so no silent gentleman's agreement or an aspect of the Grand Caucasian Consensus. It was rather an explicit royal decree from Lisbon. It was so very unnecessary, this royal order to put blacks in the front lines of battle. This would have been done anyway as a simple matter of course. The Congolese were defeated, and Ndongo and the slave traders now controlled the whole trade. And although the war waged against them was instigated by Lisbon and directed by Manuel's own representatives in Congo, the victorious traders used Ndongo for negotiations leading to a new alliance with Lisbon and the foundation for taking over all of Angola as a colony of Portugal. The defeat of Congo was the defeat of Congo, not Portugal. Even the Portuguese counselors to Diogo could now deny any responsibility for the disaster with a straight face. Yet, when Diogo died 5 years later, 1561, they were still actively on the job to choose his successor, thus promoting further turmoil in an already disintegrating nation. The murder of one king after another became almost routine. Attacks from enemy neighbors, quick to take advantage of the royal weaklings and internal chaos, marked the declining years of Congo as a great power. Yaga warriors almost gave it a death blow in 1568, but not quite. Things moved rapidly. In 1575, Angola became a colony of Portugal by a royal decree only, and Mother Congo, fighting for her own life, could only weep at the permanent loss of her great offspring. But does not the very mention of 1575 as the year Angola became a Portuguese possession, does not this seem to be sort of closing the book on the most important events prior to and after 1575, making it appear that the Congo's near collapse led to an almost immediate and easy takeover of Angola as a colony? This is the way historians generally read. Well, it was not that way at all. The disintegration of the Congolese state seemed to be complete, but it was not. There was still another revival under another line of great kings, and although the conquest of Angola was ordered by Lisbon in 1571 and began in 1575, the Portuguese, to their great surprise, had to fight their longest and bloodiest war, almost foot by foot, before Angola was finally taken nearly a half century later. They had not counted on being confronted with a black queen who would turn out to be one of the bravest generals that ever commanded an army. They had not counted on the new queen of Ndongo and Nzinga. Queen Nzinga, the Unconquerable. Greatness was born out of the savage oppression of the Africans, and out of that oppression, it grew like a giant. Just why the Portuguese drew so much blood with the lash from already chained and helpless slaves is beyond all human understanding, since, if for no other reason, the victims were articles of commerce and the source of the very riches slavers sought. Besides, over half of the captured blacks died before reaching their destination. Self-interest, then, should have stayed the murderous hands of the slavers. Nothing did, and that fact was one of the reasons that Queen Nzinga said that the real savages in Africa were the whites. They created the conditions that brought her to the fore. The Portuguese were so aggressive in their program of dividing the blacks and keeping them fighting among themselves that they overshot the mark, simply went too far. The system of spreading out over the country into the provinces and allying themselves with the various chiefs has been mentioned more than once. But after 1608, the commander-in-chief of the Portuguese army tightened the noose. This was Bento Cardoso. Under his plan, Angola was to be further depopulated by a massive onslaught for slaves through a closely coordinated system in which every chief in the land would be, quote-unquote, owned by a Portuguese and directly responsible to him for a stated quota of slaves. This would bypass the Angolan king of Ndongo, to whom the provincial chiefs paid their taxes and slaves. This would also mean increased warfare between the chiefdoms in order to meet the increased quotas demanded by raiding into each other's territories. Chiefs failing to secure the required number of slaves were themselves enslaved. Over 100 chiefs and other notables were sold into slavery in a single year, and another 100 murdered by the Portuguese. Footnote. Some accounts give 80 as the number massacred. End of footnote. We may safely assume that the actual number of chiefs enslaved or murdered was greater than that stated above, since the Portuguese, like other nations, generally cut casualty figures for the record. The situation to be considered here, however, is the widespread confusion and terror among a hunted and leaderless people. To make matters even worse, if that was possible, the half-savage Yaga, who would join anybody for their favorite game of looting and raping, became allies of Cardoso. The Angolan king, who had been cooperating with the slave traders, now saw himself being ruined on all fronts, losing his people and his profits. He therefore began to resist the Portuguese. The people, even though they knew that their king himself was a slaver, in sheer desperation flocked to support the war of resistance. Footnote. The people were actually rallying behind the king's sister, Nzinga, who had opposed him for engaging in slave trade. End of footnote. It paid off. Both the Portuguese and their Yaga allies were checked, and the war dragged on year after year. After Cabassa, the capital city, fell to the Portuguese, their losses had become so heavy that the new governor, who had been sent from Lisbon with firm orders to complete the conquest of Angola once and for all, nevertheless was forced to sue for peace without victory. The Portuguese had suffered a disastrous defeat by the blacks, but the official version and excuse was that there was general illness in their ranks. Yet the Portuguese insisted on holding Cabassa. The Africans therefore rejected peace proposals as a trick, and the war was resumed in a land of famine, where food crops and the slave trade itself had come to a standstill. In this desperate state of affairs, the fighting somehow continued, with both sides obviously weakened and in disarray. It was during this period, in 1619, that a new Portuguese commander managed to murder over 100 chiefs. At this point, the Pope intervened, insisting that the wholesale slaughter be ended and peace be pursued. In 1622, a new governor was sent from Lisbon to make peace. Portugal had been appointing governors of Angola for over 40 years without having control over it. The peace conference was held at Luanda. The black delegation was headed by the country's blessed and most uncompromising diplomat, Anne Nzinga, not yet queen, but sister of the king. The woman power behind a weak king and the one responsible for inspiring the people to continue the war of resistance when every hope was gone, unless she herself had become their last hope. But even before the peace conference began, and at the risk of wrecking it, the governor's Caucasian arrogance could not be restrained. He had decided on a studied insult at the outset by providing chairs in the conference room only for himself and his counselors, with the idea of forcing the black princess to stand humbly before his noble presence. He remained seated, of course, staring haughtily as she entered the room. She took in the situation at a glance with a contemptuous smile, while her attendants moved with a swiftness that seemed to suggest that they had anticipated this stupid behavior by the Portuguese. They quickly rolled out the beautifully designed royal carpet they had brought before Nzinga, after which one of them went down on all fours and expertly formed himself into a royal throne upon which the princess sat easily without being a strain on her devoted follower. Yet she rose at regular intervals, knowing that other attendants were vying for the honor of thus giving to these whites still another defeat. I gather from the different ways this incident is reported that the Western mind is unable to grasp its real meaning. Some historians saw it as a cruel and inhuman use of slaves, ignoring the fact that Nzinga's chief claim to fame was that she was the greatest abolitionist of slavery, that she herself had no slaves and, indeed, and not the slightest need for any. One reason might well be that she was so much loved and even blindly followed by her people that it was believed that all would die to the last man and woman following her leadership. Such were the men, not slaves, who gladly formed a human couch before the astonished Portuguese for their leader. She faced the Portuguese governor and spoke as a ruler of the land, and not as a subject of the King of Portugal. She did not recognize the man in the big chair as governor because she did not recognize the existence of a Portuguese colony of Angola. She only saw before her what her people had seen approaching their shores over 100 years before. Pompous white devils bent on the destruction of the non-white world. The Ndongo terms for peace were presented as uncompromising demands, and it was clear from the beginning that the Portuguese would have fared better with the man. For before any kind of treaty was signed, Portugal had to agree, one, to evacuate Cabasa and all nearby fortifications, two, the Portuguese were to wage war against the Yaga, a harsh provision since the Yaga had been Portugal's allies in trying to crush Ndongo. 3. All chiefs who had become vassals of the Portuguese king were to be freed and enabled to return to former tributary status at home. And finally, the important concession Nzinga made was to return the Portuguese prisoners of war she held. The Treaty of 1622 was supposed to end all fighting in the whole West Central region, but the governor, as though to make up for his defeat in the peace negotiations with Nzinga, marched off to invade Congo again almost immediately. The treaty then became dead insofar as its execution was concerned, but Nzinga's brother died the next year and she became queen of Ndongo. The distressed Portuguese, in order to discredit her, put out the story that she had poisoned him. And while there was not a scintilla of evidence or any basis at all for the concoction, historians have shown their unbiased objectivity by faithfully carrying on the charge for over 300 years. Yet, if lying is a legitimate aspect of warfare, the Portuguese may have felt justified in trying to destroy such an implacable foe in any way they could. Footnote. I am not unaware that Nzinga hated her brother, not only because he was a slave trader, but also because he had murdered her young son, who, being the king's nephew, was heir to the throne. End of footnote. Their greatest trouble was yet to come. Nzinga became queen in 1623 and went into action at once. Her first major move was to send an ultimatum to the Portuguese authorities demanding the immediate execution of the terms of the treaty. Otherwise, war would be declared. While the Portuguese were preparing to meet the Queen's armies, the Dutch fleet appeared as a new threat. The Dutch, themselves great slavers, certainly did not come as liberators of the hard-pressed blacks. Their aim was to break the Portuguese monopoly and secure their share of the slave trade and the mineral wealth of West and Central Africa. To further these ends, they used the blacks as other white people did and still do. So no time was lost in forming an alliance with Pedro II, King of Congo, in his war with the Portuguese. The Dutch had already captured 7 Portuguese slave ships at sea, sunk other vessels in the harbors at Luanda and Mpinda, and were raising hell generally. All this gave Queen Nzinga more time to prepare for the inevitable. She even reversed her demands for a Portuguese war against the Yaga and formed a military alliance with them herself. Knowing how very unreliable the Yaga were, she sought to make the alliance binding by promising to marry the Yaga chief, Kasanji, and adopting certain desirable Yaga customs. Nzinga's greatest act, however, and probably the one that makes her one of the greatest women in history, was in 1624 when she declared all territory in Angola over which she had control was free country. All slaves reaching it from whatever quarter were forever free. She went further, since it was clear to her that white power in Africa rested squarely on the use of black troops against black people. She undertook the first and only carefully organized effort to undermine and destroy the effective employment and use of black soldiers by whites. The first and only black leader in history who was ever known to undertake such a task. She had carefully selected groups of her own soldiers to infiltrate the Portuguese black armies, first separating and spreading out individually into Portuguese-held territory and allowing themselves to be induced by Portuguese recruiting agents to join their forces. The quiet and effective work of Nzinga's agents among the black troops of Portugal was one of the most glorious yet unsung pages in African history. For whole companies rebelled and deserted to the colors of the Black Queen, taking with them the much-needed guns and ammunition which she had been unable to secure except by swiftly moving surprise attacks on enemy units. The Queen's armies were further strengthened by the runaway slaves who streamed into the only certain haven for the free on the whole continent of Africa. To the Portuguese, Queen Nzinga had passed the last word in unheard-of audacity when she was able to influence scores of vassal chiefs to rebel against them and join the cause of their own race. This was too much. This woman had to be destroyed. It had to come to that. The Portuguese sent their ultimatum to the Queen from their Luanda stronghold, Portugal's Lisbon in Africa. It demanded the immediate return of all chiefs, soldiers, and slaves to Portuguese territory, that is, all who had fled therefrom. Refusal would mean war. The ultimatum concluded. The fact was that a state of war already existed since the Queen's own ultimatum of the previous year. The Portuguese were afraid to move against her then, and they were even more afraid to move against her stronger forces now. Although they continued to give the Dutch threat as the reason for delaying the required all-out attack. Meanwhile, the usual strategy of first instigating factional strife among the blacks was by no means forgotten. It was just that there was so much unity and patriotism in this dominant Angola state, so much fanatical devotion to this terrible black queen, that internal subversion was almost impossible. They tried to overcome all this by formally declaring that Nzinga was not legally queen of Ndongo, the throne vacant, and one of their own vassal chiefs, I.D. Kiluanji, was declared king. The Portuguese marshaled all of their forces on land and sea, their special river fleets in particular, to crush Nzinga before the Dutch struck again. But the queen herself opened the offensive, striking first at the Portuguese puppet king and his forces. The Portuguese captured her principal island stronghold in the Kwanza River in July 1626, thus dividing her forces and, by swift encircling movement designed to capture the queen, cut off her main supporting regiments, and forced her not only to retreat, but to withdraw from her country. Joy reigned at Luanda and Sao Tome. With Nzinga's flight from Angola, it appeared that the black menace was over and victory complete. I.D. Kiluanji was crowned King Philip I of Ndongo. The solidarity of the blacks remained unbroken, however, and their loyalty to Nzinga remained steadfast. She was just away a little while and would soon return. Any child in the most distant bush could tell you that their queen was just away on business. So who was this Philip I? His name said he was a Portuguese, so he couldn't be king of Ndongo. All Angolan kings and queens were so African that they couldn't be tricked out of their own African names. The queen herself had dropped Anna from her name when she discovered that baptizing a black into Christianity meant surrendering his soul and body, not to any Christ, but to the white man. And oral tradition further has it that the people not only rejected Philip I, but made fun of the very idea that he considered himself to be king. Their blind faith in their queen and the certainty of her return, according to the same oral record, was not really so blind. Those who understood the coded drum messages spread the news that all guerrilla attacks which occurred throughout the land were attacks which were personally directed by the queen, and that, in fact, she was raising a new army of liberation. Her loyal chiefs and people in Ndongo were to stand by, ready. The written record, no matter how slanted, supports the oral, for in November 1627, she crossed the borders back into her country at the head of a strong army, made stronger and stronger as her loyal chiefs and wildly cheering people, including her fanatically devoted freedmen, flocked to her standard as she swept forward to recapture the Kwanza stronghold held by Philip I and put him to flight. The Portuguese continued to be amazed at this display of black unity, and under a woman's leadership at that. Black unity was now seen clearly as black power, and that meant an unconquerable people. The Portuguese were resolved to break that unity and the power that developed from it. The revolt against them had become general as Nzinga's victorious forces advanced. The Portuguese retreated to their own strongholds on the coast, giving the Dutch threat as an excuse, and not the threat of being annihilated by the Queen's forces. But as there was in fact no imminent Dutch threat, the Portuguese regrouped and strengthened their forces for an all-out war to destroy Nzinga, and this time not to cease fighting until this was done. They began by giving orders and offering a big reward for her capture, dead or alive. Their slave troops, still the backbone of the Portuguese armed forces, were given the special inducements of land and freedom for her capture. Realizing that such an all-out attempt to capture her meant that countless thousands of her people would die in her defense, she outwitted the Portuguese again by slipping out of the country, instructing her lieutenants to spread the word everywhere that she had fled the country, mistakenly entered the territory of an enemy, and had been killed. To give point to the story, there was general weeping and mourning throughout Ndongo. Real weeping and mourning, because the masses believed the story to be true. So did the Portuguese. The only reason for the war having been removed by Providence, the bishop could celebrate a special mass in celebration of this special blessing, and the colony of Angola could at last be organized after over 50 years of obstruction. All things now seem to be happy and going well according to the original grand design. Then, in 1629, the Portuguese stood aghast when Queen Nzinga burst upon them from the grave, sweeping all opposition before her. She brought in her fierce Yaga allies with her, apparently willing to do even this to defeat the whites. The Portuguese were completely defeated. She had not only retaken her own country, but had meanwhile become queen of Matamba also, having replaced the weak queen there. Nzinga was now an empress of two countries. She now redoubled her campaign against slavery and the slave trade by making both Ndongo and Matamba havens for all who could escape from the slaver by rebelling or otherwise. Footnote: Queen Nzinga's anti-slavery crusade did not mean that she herself did not hold her own captives in bondage, including the Portuguese. The Portuguese had changed the nature of slavery into a racial pattern, and Nzinga was particularly ruthless with captured black chiefs who were allies of the whites. She did not hesitate to sell such chiefs and their followers into slavery. End of footnote. Chiefs engaged in the traffic in nearby states now stood in fear of her wrath. The Portuguese saw the handwriting on the wall. In order not to lose every foothold in the area, Lisbon suddenly remembered that it had never carried out the treaty signed with Nzinga in 1622, and declared that Portugal's wars against her had been unjust. High-level embassies were sent to the Queen in 1639 in efforts to effect a settlement. Nzinga received them, listened to their protestations of eternal friendship, and went ahead with determination in reorganizing both of her kingdoms and undermining colonial rule in areas held by the enemy. That every white man in Africa was an enemy of the blacks was a matter about which there was no room for debate in her mind. Even the holy robes of the priests in Angola not only covered their real mission as agents of empire, but also covered their insatiable lust for the black bodies of their helpless slave girls. Footnote: the Queen was further outraged over the success of the Portuguese in capturing both of her younger sisters. This gave the enemy a most powerful bargaining weapon, yet she continued to reject all of their principal demands, with the result that her sisters, to whom she was deeply devoted, remained in captivity for many years. End of footnote. She had been forced by the actualities of black-white relations to distrust all whites, along with their tricky treaties. By 1641, the Dutch had made great progress in reducing the power of Portugal along the coast, and Nzinga's adamant position made their situation an impossible one to maintain. So a despairing governor and a council had no choice but to declare war against her once again, a full-scale war. But the situation was now most favorable for the Angolans. Their neighbor, Congo, had become more active in its own war against the Portuguese, and besides, a new and greater king had assumed the leadership. This was Garcia II, who continued the policy of cooperating with the Dutch where and when Congolese interests were involved. Some black leaders had learned to use the whites as they had always used them, when it served their own interest. The other happy development for Ndongo was that the Dutch invasion of Portuguese-held areas had actually begun in 1641, before any moves could be made against either of the two black states, Congo and Ndongo. Footnote: we must continue to skip over much in every region that is briefly covered in this work. This is often painful, as here, for example, I am unable to deal with the quite relevant struggle of the unconquerable Dembo people against the Portuguese in slavery. But this must wait until black history is written in depth, period by period, region by region, and state by state. End of footnote. Nzinga continued her campaign against the Portuguese, winning victories everywhere a battle was joined. With Dutch aid, the great Portuguese stronghold of Masangano fell in 1648. The Dutch, having previously captured Luanda, now found themselves threatened by the steady reinforcements that continued to pour in from Portuguese Brazil. The Dutch withdrew, leaving the blacks in the area, who had helped them to capture and defend this, the most important Portuguese city in Africa, to fend for themselves alone. While the chiefs and their forces did indeed put up a gallant fight, they were massacred in one of the most savage onslaughts on record. The recapture of Luanda by Salvador de Sá, the new governor, and his crushing of black opposition there led him to initiate new peace efforts with Congo and Nzinga's two kingdoms. The Congolese king refused to answer his letter, but did send a monk to hear the governor's terms. Nzinga also agreed to efforts at negotiations. These gestures by the two African leaders led Salvador de Sá to advise the King of Portugal that all the African states were cowed and their power broken. He knew better, of course, for even the chiefs and their people in his own Portuguese-held territory were still fighting on despite the massacres, and probably because of them. If the Portuguese had been able to conquer either Congo or Ndongo Matamba, no peace offers would have been made. Hadn't they tried it over and over and failed? To be able to conquer both now was out of the question. So the old conquest route was being tried again. The beguiling smiles and protestations of friendship, finding concrete expression in negotiations for peace. The language of diplomacy reached its most brilliant heights of deception in those velvety clauses of proposed treaties with the Africans. If they signed them, would be signing themselves and their people into perpetual bondage. This fact was supposed to be assured by the other fact that the relevant clauses were so ambiguous that they could be interpreted in several different ways. In this case, in whatever way the Portuguese chose to interpret them, the very same provisions of the treaties could be read and explained to the blacks in such language that it would appear that the Europeans were not only humbling themselves, but also proclaiming that outcome as a glorious victory for the Africans. For, of course, no blacks, not even an Nzinga, was supposed to be intelligent enough, sharply intelligent enough, to see through all this. But, stripping away all the glittering verbiage, Nzinga saw at a glance that what it all meant was that she was to be a vassal of the Portuguese king, and one paying him a big annual tribute. She would die first, and no one should have known this better than the Portuguese, who at the time of this latest treaty offer had been at war with her and repeatedly defeated for over 28 years. They had met one of the giants of the human race, which they found impossible to recognize as such because she appeared on the planet not only as a woman, but one with black skin. Nzinga, therefore, kept them anxiously waiting for action on the treaty, toying with it for 6 years, while giving her war-torn land and tired-out people a period for rest and recovery. She was the same queen who had twice fled the country, not to save herself, but to save her people from a slaughter that her flight would prevent. For the same reason, she did not want the war resumed again, after over 40 years of warfare. On the other hand, she would not surrender her country to Portugal and its slave trade. The areas of Angola they still held, including the important islands of Luanda and Sao Tome, belonged to the Angolan people, and some of these areas belonged directly to her own kingdoms of Ndongo and Matamba. Finally, then, in 1656, tired and weary from 4 decades of relentless struggles, she signed a treaty that was revised and made acceptable to her. Her greatest concession allowed the Portuguese puppet king, Adi, to head the territory conceded to them. There were 7 more years of a busy life for Queen Nzinga. Pushing reconstruction, the resettlement of ex-slaves, and undertaking the development of an economy of free men and women that would be able to succeed without the slave trade, she could not have been unaware that with the Portuguese still strongly entrenched in the most strategic areas, unless she was succeeded by equally great leaders, all of her labors in defense of the freedom of the blacks would ultimately be in vain. That was the burning question in 1663, as a dull autumn sun lengthened the shadows over the palace grounds where thousands stood in tears. Were there any more Garcias anywhere? Would God send them another Nzinga to hold the line against the truly white devils? The sun slowly went down behind the Angolan trees and darkness spread over the land. Over 300 years later, the blacks of Angola are still fighting the Portuguese and still waiting for the sunrise. In the heart-torn state of national mourning, the Queen's Council permitted 2 priests to come in and perform the last rites of the church. Since the Queen had renounced the Catholic religion many years before her passing, had banned missions from her country as centers of subversion, this appearance of priests at the royal bedside may be explained either as a once a Catholic, always a Catholic theory, or as an attempt by Catholic Portugal to give the appearance of final victory on all fronts. In this case, it would mean that the most unconquerable of foes, recanting and submissive, had been conquered by their religion in the end. And so it is written in the official documents of Portugal, written that Nzinga returned to the church that had baptized her. Anna, the written record used by almost all historians of Africa. Yet she was one of the very first of the blacks to see that the Portuguese conquest, the slave trade, and the church were all inseparably one and the same. The long years of warfare had been equally against all three, the unholy trinity. She never surrendered to either. In 1963, 300 years after her death, her people, now Catholic themselves, did not believe she ever returned to the church. Footnote: for a more detailed study of Queen Nzinga, see Roy Arthur Glasgow's The Warrior Queen, John Wiley and Sons, 1969, and Queen Nzinga and the Mbundu Resistance to the Portuguese Slave Trade, scheduled for publication 1971 by Oxford University Press. Note in particular the great difference in the account of the last days of the Queen and that of mine. End of footnote.